Simon Wallin. You can find me on Twitter. I work as a consultant here in Sweden. I do some blogging, I do some PowerShell training, and I'm really passionate about identity and automation. So, well, since PowerShell and Active Directory is a really good match, I've kind of found my sweet spot. So today I'm going to talk a little bit about the Active Directory module, which comes with the Windows Server, and then I'm going to show you how I've combined different commandlets in that module to create my own tools, which is supposed to be used interactively in PowerShell. So instead of using GUI tools, you can just type some commands and do stuff. So first off, the Active Directory module, when I found it and started using it quite a while ago, I found out that it's often faster than using the GUI tools. So if you gonna check up the user, get group members, or whatever you do in your day-to-day Active Directory work, it's often faster to write one line of PowerShell than it is to open up a GUI and try to find a user or a menu or click and stuff and go into different tabs and so on. Also, the Active Directory module is really easily available. It's by default available in the server, and you can download and install on any client. And it's really easy to learn for simple tasks. So for everything that can be performed by one commandlet in the Active Directory module, it's usually way faster than trying to use the GUI tool. So it's been available since version 2, and you can run it on any modern server. Your DCs have to be 2008 R2, and if they don't, you can even run it on 2003 R2 SP2 with a gateway service. You install it with one command on any server, and if you're on a client, you can use remote server administration tools. The first thing I always tell people to do with PowerShell and Active Directory is to enable the recycle bin, because once you've done it, there's a great way to recover objects that you delete by mistake. It could be a script gone wrong, deleting a bunch of stuff, or just someone by accident deleting something, and you get a great way to recover it. And I'll show you a demo of that later on. But there are a few scenarios where the Active Directory module doesn't do the work in one or two commandlets. And I've chosen to call those complex scenarios, not because they're hard to understand or something that's hard to do. It's just when I get to do something, or I have to do something interactive in PowerShell, and I have to use 2, 3, 4, or 5 commandlets and probably use the output from one to the other, it's time consuming to write. So I don't want to write all those commands every time I get to do something. Also, it has a high PowerShell skill requirement. Someone just new to PowerShell can easily learn to use simple one commands, but teaching them how to use a bunch of commands and do like ad hoc scripting is a lot harder. And also, when you start to do ad hoc scripting interactively in console, it's error prone. It's easily that someone writes something that they think performs one thing and then performs something else without giving an error. So you might not want everyone in the organization trying to write interactive scripts. Or if you're new to PowerShell, maybe you're not comfortable with writing interactive scripts or scripts interactively in the console. So what I've done is to combine commandlets from the Active Directory module into my own module, which I posted on GitHub yesterday. And these are tools made for maybe help desk or operations personnel that can type one command instead of a bunch of them. And it's scenarios where I think that the Active Directory module is too, I have to run too many commands to get the output that I want to. So first scenario I'm going to show you is resetting passwords. Resetting a password is really simple, especially in a GUI. Right click something and choose reset password. But there are a few, maybe not problems, but first of all, you have to come up with a good password. Have you seen these passwords?
Yeah.
They're maybe not the best passwords to give someone. So when I reset someone's password, I want the complex generated password, and I don't want to come up with it myself, because it's going to end up being summer 2015. Also, when I change someone's password, I probably want to force them to change it on next.com. And if I want to do that with PowerShell, there's one command to set the password, another command to force them to change next.com. So, and sometimes I can't really force them to change next.com because maybe they're out in the field somewhere accessing external web systems or whatever, and that doesn't support users changing passwords at first.com. So they'll end up being locked out and call me back again and ask for a new password reset. So if I allow the user, or if I don't force the user to reset their password next.com, if they have a complex, hard to remember password, they will be more inclined to choose to change the password than if the password is summer 2015, which is easy to remember, and sometimes users even ask, please can you set the summer 15? I got that last time and that was really good because I can remember it. And in the end you end up having 20% of all the users in the organization having the password summer 2015. So giving a user a complex password is not only complex, but it also it inclines the user to, or motivates the user to change their own password to something they remember. Also, when you change someone's password or reset the password, you will probably want to unlock the account, because if it's unlocked, maybe they have a phone syncing or something, you will want to unlock the account just before you ask the user to try the new password. And there is a third command in PowerShell. And the last bit of it is, usually this kind of communication is a user calls in to help us or to someone on call and identifies them somewhere, hopefully, somehow. Maybe answers some questions about private information. And once the password is reset, you have to read the password out loud to the user. And reading summer 2015 to a user is really simple. But reading like capital V, lowercase x, exclamation mark, pound, and so on might be harder. And I can never remember those NATO spelling words. So I always get stuck in trying to read phonetic words. So that's the first thing we're gonna look at. So here's my demo domain controller. It's a server with a client installed, because I want to have everything on one machine for doing demos and less moving parts. So first of all, I have a module that I call SWAD for Simon Wallin Active Directory, and it has a requirement of the Active Directory module, so you'll need to have the Active Directory module installed to load it. And for the first part of changing passwords, I've written a command called new SW random password, which I can run, and it gives me an 8-character random password, which is truly randomized and consists of at least one of each of 4 character groups. It always consists of at least one lowercase character, at least one uppercase character, at least one number, and at least one special character. And if I want anything else, I can choose, first off, either specify both min password length and max password length to have a dynamic length of the password. So I can say I want one password between 8 and 15 characters, and it's gonna randomize the length. Or I can have a static length, saying password length and, well, say 12. And if I'm not happy with the characters that the command is used for generating the passwords, I can create my own loops by using the parameter input strings. An input strings takes an array of strings. Every string will be one character groups. So if I want a password generated from the lowercase characters ABC, and I want the uppercase characters DEF, and I want the, let's say, numbers 789, and maybe a special character being exclamation mark and pound sign. So I only want my passwords to be generated from these characters, and well, obviously I should probably have a little bit more characters in each group, but the script will make sure that at least one character from each group is used in every password. And I can also add count and say I want 10 passwords. So this will generate 10 random passwords out of the strings that I've specified.
this way you could basically override complexity requirements. Password complexity.
Yeah, if my password complexity rules says that I need, states that I need at least one out of four groups, then if I specify four groups, I will definitely get one from each group. But this is just creating the password, it's not setting them. So if you choose to generate a password that doesn't fulfill your password policy, it's not going to work to set it. So, and some systems that is not Active Directory can't handle passwords that doesn't start with a character or that doesn't start with a something. So to handle that, I also added the first character parameter, which will allow me to specify a new group which only the first character in the password will be generated from. So I can say the first character has to be a lowercase letter, and I should probably put both lowercase and uppercase, but I don't want to stand here typing all day. So we can see that the first character here is all. Scroll up so you can see. The first character and all the passwords are all lowercase a to h, and all the others are randomized, and all of these characters fulfill the password requirements for Active Directory being complex in Active Directory, since it contains all four different character groups. So this is the first part that I wrote, and then I'm going to skip to the last part of resetting passwords, which is reading the password out loud to a user. And if you, like me, don't like or have hard time to remember,
I just made something. I
yeah.
To be a, but when you put in the first character, that string,
yeah,
it actually defies the input string's parameter. So you have lowercase ABC,
yeah,
but some passwords now contain DEFG, H lowercase, which are not member of the input strings.
Well, only for the first characters. You don't
exactly,
have any.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But they're not part of the input strings allowed
exactly.
Characters. Yeah.
So the first character
yeah.
Parameter overrides the input strings and says, for the first character, you randomize one character from the first character.
So you could specify capital A, and every password would be
correct.
We'll
start with capital A.
Yeah.
So if I want to, I can create a password starting with password followed by number, by typing only one input string being numbers, and the word. Well, the word password won't work, so but one character will work. So I can have A in the number. And this is not enforcing in any way. It's not supposed to force anyone to generate passwords that fulfills a certain requirement. You can, if you just run the command with the default parameters, it will choose one lowercase, one uppercase, one number, and one special character. But if you're not happy with that, if you want something else, then you can specify your own input strings. But it's designed to make it possible to easily generate passwords that fulfill any password requirement. So to the last part of the password reset process is to read the password out loud to the user. And for that, oops, I wrote this function that I call get SW phonetic. And it takes one parameter, which is the char, and it takes a char array. And if you specify a string, PowerShell will automatically pass that to a char array. So if I say I want a password, I have a password like this, and I run it, it's going to tell me, scroll up a bit, it's going to tell me here's the input text I got, so I can easily copy paste the input text to an email or wherever I want to put it, and it's also going to type out the password in phonetic spelling.
Phonetic, it's not telling me if it's a capital or not.
It does, because it's Sierra is capital, all caps, because the S is capital, and the H is lowercase, so hotel is lowercase.
You just shout louder.
Yeah, exactly. Now, you have to, it doesn't tell you it's uppercase, but it's uppercase letters. So if I'm going to read this password to you, I will probably say uppercase Sierra, lowercase hotel, and so on. Since
okay.
Hotel is lowercase, Sierra is uppercase, golf lowercase, Roman lowercase.
I'm thinking more like a system that calls the user and tells it its new password.
No, it's not going to read
okay.
it for it. But
okay.
if I run this command and I'm going to tell you the password I just generated.
But that's an easy add-on to do.
Yeah, I'm thinking
yeah.
about self-service and this is help desk.
Yeah,
okay.
sure. Yeah. And I'm using a function to check if this is uppercase, then this is uppercase. So you can use the same thing. The string type has a static function that is uppercase. So if I said in the help desk, I can now get the spelling. And if I don't like this way of spelling, there is a second parameter to the function, which is phonetic table. So I can specify a hash table containing all the characters I want to spell or want to be able to spell. And I can choose how to display them. So for instance, I can say A should be Adam. Adam. B. B should be Little, and so on, which is the Swedish way of reading phonetics instead of the number spelling. So if I would do that, it will say Adam Berl and so on. So I can, and if I had multiple language I need to read in, I can easily specify global variables in my partial profile and have them loaded. So I can say phonetic table Swedish, if I had it. So, then we covered how to generate passwords and how to read passwords. And for the middle part of that, I did a reset password, which I call reset SWAD password. And what this does is it will generate me a new password, it will set the password, it will set the user to change the password on next logon, and it will show me the phonetics of the password that was generated. So I give it, I think that is my username here. And now my password is Bravo Uniform percentage Zulu Zulu 5 quote 2. And if if one character is not in the shared table, it'll just print out as it is.
Is that a proof verb reset?
Sorry?
Is it a proof verb reset?
I think so.
Yeah.
I think reset is. Good. It's a proof verb.
It's quite a common notion. I'll shut up.
So this way I can get a simple way to reset passwords. I can make sure that all the passwords that we give the users are good random passwords. And since the password is hard to remember, the users are highly motivated to change the passwords themselves. But in this case, I would have to change my password on next logon. if I want to, I can also specify no change, and this password would be, with this password I would be able to log on multiple times without changing it. But the user getting this password would probably like to change it as soon as possible. So that's about changing passwords. Next part is about auditing. A lot of companies have some kind of auditing policy. It could be like PCI compliance, it could be SOX, and a lot of governmental rules about what you're allowed to do and not allowed to do, who should have access to this and that, and so on. So that usually results in some auditor coming to the company asking a lot of questions like, who's a member of that group? Who has access to this share? Who can do this? What are the access levels of this person? And so on. And usually they're a bit tricky because they like to ask several persons the same question. So sometimes when an auditor comes and asks, can you please show me all members of this group, and I give them the members, they get, usually I just use, I get the group member and recurse it, and I get all the members of that group. And then later on, the same auditor comes back and say, you know, I asked your colleague to answer the same question, and he gave me pictures of the real information in Active Directory, and that information contains it contains groups, and also it contains contacts. Now, the auditor is not an Active Directory specialist, it's just someone who's really good in processes and auditing. So, they don't know that contacts don't get access to something, even if they're part of a group. But they do see that there's an entry in one of the answers that isn't in the other. So, I got tired of not getting contacts, because if I use get the group member, it won't show me any context that is a member of a group. So that's the first problem with using get any group members when an auditor asks for group membership. The next part is get any group member doesn't show me if a user is enabled or disabled. If a user is disabled, it should probably not be in a group, especially not a group like domain admins or something, but it's better to have a disabled user in a group that have that isn't supposed to be there than have an activated user or enabled user that in a group that isn't supposed to be there. So I want to show if the members of the group is enabled or disabled. And also when I do get any group member recursively and I get all the group members of a group, it's really hard when someone gets back to me and say, this person shouldn't be a member of this group, fix it. And then I have to go through all the groups and try and figure out how that person or that user is a member of a group, because it's probably a member of a group, which is a member of a group, which is a member of a group, which is a member of this group. So that's three main reasons why I decided to write my first own get SWAD group member. And also, sometimes I get the question in reverse. Please tell me all, give me all the groups that this person or this object is a member of. So I want to do it backwards. And that's the next part. So get SWAD group member works similar to get AD group member, but it will give me objects with that tells me if the member is enabled or not, and it'll show contacts. So I think I have a group called management, and we can see that I get two members of that group. The first one is Ossian Haraldsson, and the second one is Sigurd Johansson. And the second one is of the object class contact, and the first one is a user. So when I run this command, I get two objects, one contact and one user. If I use get AD group member, I only get the first one, which is the user. So if I give an auditor this result and someone else gives the auditor this result, the auditor is going to be confused and come back and ask, why are you guys giving me a different answer on the same question?
Are you using custom LDAP query or get AD object?
I'm using get AD object.
So just a quick question with in regards to the user part, not the contact part.
Mm-hmm.
The enable part, you could just pipe the result of whatever you got into get AD group member into get AD user, and you would get the same
yes.
result. Yeah.
Exactly. I'm select enable.
Yeah.
That would be the same. I just have to do twice as much typing.
Yeah. Okay.
And also, this is not the main reason why I did this. I'm going to show you the main reason why. This is just something I got while doing it. So, but yes, I can just pipe get AD member to get AD user, and I can get information. But it'll do a lot more lookups to the AD on me. And it probably won't. Anyway, it will work. So, next part is the report. So there's not many auditors that really is interested. Let's see if I can scroll up. Really interested in this output. I can pipe it to CSV and I can open it in Excel, but they still don't care about the SAM account name or object class and so on. They just want to know the name of the users within a group. And sometimes I just want a quick overview of how a group is nested into other groups. So that's my real goal, and that's when I did the get AD group member, sorry, get SW AD group member report. So what this command does is it calls the first command and then it formats the output as a bunch of strings, and it gives me a nice overview of how something is nested. So I have a group called FD folder 1, I think it is R. This gives me a quick output telling me that folder 1R has two members directly. I did some symbols here to know what which kind of objects I get. So first I took equal sign, which is two minuses. And that's a mnemonic I use to remember that two minuses is a disabled computer count. So I have a disabled computer count named server 1. And this is almost like a plus, which is tilted with a strange dollar in it. So it's an enabled computer count. And then the pound sign shows me groups. This paragraph character is a contact. And all these plus and minuses are enabled and disabled users. So this gives me a really quick overview. I can't really use it to pipe somewhere, but if someone asks who's a member of this group, I can simply do this, pipe it to a text file, and send them a text file, and I can quickly see how the group is nested, who's a member, who's enabled, who's not enabled, who's the contact, and who's the server, and so on. So shows that the FD folder 2 has one group member and one user member who's disabled.
What attribute is coming out for those users?
By default, it's the attribute name.
Object name.
Yeah, it's the attribute name, so what you will see as display name in the GUI.
Can it be changed?
Yes. You have a property and that takes distinguished name and SAM account name. So I can choose to display SAM account name or distinguished name in my report instead. And this looks a little bit weird in this resolution. But here you can see the same report contain distinguished names for all the objects. And it could probably be changed to anything. The code is open source and you're welcome to add any property you like to. So the same thing in reverse, which groups is the user member of. get AD, SW AD group membership. Make sure if I'm a not a member of any groups. Let's do the group member report on Sam account name. And that's our discount name. Membership identity. Okay, so scroll a bit here so we can see what happens. Here is the same as get the group member, but in reverse. So this gives me all the groups a person or object is a member of, and it does it recursively. So that's why you see the same group many times, I think. No, no duplicate, but it could be duplicates because one person can be a member of the same group in different ways.
So you didn't do the tree there?
No, that's the report.
Yeah.
So if I do the get the W, and also for the group membership, I can choose properties. So if I want to, I can say I also want to display some account name. And name and something else. So I can choose any amount of properties that I want to display, and as long as that property exists on a group, it will work. Or I can say it's the name, and you'll get the system company name of the machine as well. So this just gives me basic PowerShell objects. But of course my goal was to do a report, so get some new group membership report, scroll up a bit. And I get the same tree structure telling me that this user is a direct member of Golf Players and Developers. And Golf Players is a member of these two groups, which in turn is this is part of this, and part of this developers is member of FT3C.
Are you using the tree command for this, or have you built your own?
I built my own. So I'm building text strings with the string dot format.
With handle, you've got groups that actually stuck, so back on each other.
That's a good question. Let's do the group member report, for instance, identity. I have a group called group 1, I think. And group 1 is a member of group 2, which is a member of group 3, which is a member of group 1.
Hmm.
So
what if you're a member of a certain group in multiple ways, multiple other groups?
That will work. So it has to be a closed loop. You can be a member of the same group. And many different. I think I can demonstrate it. So this gives me a warning. It stops the output and say we have a nested group because group 1 and group 3 are nested. And they're not directly nested. It's group 1 is member of group 2, which is member of group 3, which is a member of group 1 again. So they don't have to be nested directly. It can be nested in a long circle. And I can bring up the GUI here just to show you the groups. You see group 1 as a member of group 2, which is a member of group 3, which is a member of group 1. And Jeff asked if we can...
This group is a member of this. If you make this group directly member of this one, will it show...
Yeah, that would be a loop,
separate
right?
No, sure.
No.
Two ways to the same group, only three.
Yes.
Yeah, sure. That shouldn't be a problem. So, let's say... Let's go back to this one.
That's an issue one of my customers had now.
Alright. So we should be doing a report on this actually. So I have this one, and if I put, let's say, on our scrolls, you'll see.
And if you put 401A, 401R into...
into developers.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, into 402C.
What do you see?
So, this group and the members should be this group.
Yes.
Sure. That shouldn't be a problem. So this is not a loop. And if it's not a loop, it's not going to detect this loop. The user is a member of this group, the folder 3C here, and the folder 3C there. So it's a valid scenario, it doesn't generate a loop. But as soon as you generate a loop, you will get the warning.
It's not an issue.
So the one that did the user part, or that you already had some mnemonic support in regards to
mm-hmm.
enable, disable. Do you have that documented somewhere, or is it part of the commandlet some way, or?
It will be part of the help. If you get help. And if you don't like the...
Tomorrow is on the help session.
Exactly. also, if you don't like the part, let's see, Git AD group member report. Where is it? There it is. Oh, group one is bad. Let's take this group, or let's take this group. So if I want to change all these characters, there is a parameter for that, that is type dictionary. And I specify a hash table where the key is the object type and the value is code snippet in string format, because I'm going to build a script block from that string and execute it, meaning that I can say if object is enabled, do plus, others, do minus.
If a user is a member of a group twice by different routes,
mm-hmm.
will it display twice in this report or not?
Yeah, it'll display twice.
Just it.
So, well, in this case, it's if we did.
But it's a group.
Yeah, this is one group. But if a user is a member in more than one of the groups in the tree, the user will be displayed in every part. So it draws a tree or a tree structure showing the membership.
Can you in some way like highlight a member, if a user is a member of two groups and they're into each other as you demonstrated before,
mm-hmm.
Can you like highlight the groups that are listed by the same name, let's say a user has like 50 groups, so
but
it can be
first thing is if I can highlight the username if it's a member of more than...
If the user is in the group twice,
yeah,
as you showed before.
If there are multiple paths from the user to a single group.
Yeah,
if I can do a highlight.
If
probably it's not a function within these functions right now, but that might be a good idea for
what
you have.
You can just highlight the user that you have in control find and highlight the user.
Sure,
yeah.
That works. I can copy paste it to Notepad++.
Can you even do that?
A script or something
that's
like that where output every single path, and if the user is the username and the path, those two keys are, I only sort that. If the the output is has a value of 2 or 1 or bigger, then I'll edit it.
Yeah.
Then of course the question is, where do you put your stuff and can we contribute to it?
Yeah, the stuff is on GitHub right now. It's I'll show you the URL, and it will probably be in the PowerShell gallery by the end of this week, if I just get to try to help finish first. But you're welcome to help me with that also. And any issues, requests, just write an issue on GitHub, and I'll do my best to fix it. And if you have a solution for it, please contribute. I would love to have someone contributing.
You could have grading colors, so if it's in 50 groups, you'll have red, and in 25 groups, it'll be yellow.
Yeah, sure, you could change color. Oh, I'm using right output here, so all these things are strings, it's not the right host. So it will be hard to change colors. But with PowerShell 5, I can use right information and get it. Yes?
A quick question. Why did you use get and not show when you're not outputting objects, and why didn't you output objects?
The question is, why do I use the verb get instead of show?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Okay. Fair enough. Pull request.
Yeah, exactly. Maybe it should be show a group member report, not get member report.
Makes sense.
I just thought I'd get a report.
Technically, it would be something more like generate.
Yeah. I can pipe this to clip, and it'll put in the clipboard, or to set the clipboard, and then I can open an email or wherever I want it and just paste it. So that's usually how I use it. And it's not really why I did it. It was not to make it something automatable, even if I really like automate stuff. It's just because I'm lazy and I don't want to write a bunch of commands ad hoc in the console when I want to answer questions like this from an auditor. So the last thing I'm going to talk about is the oops factor. Sometimes something happens that wasn't supposed to happen. It could be a human error. Well, it's probably a human error even if it's the script gone wrong, because it's the human writing scripts that made something wrong, but sometimes objects get deleted by mistake, and that's a hassle. So restoring them from the recycle bin is quite easy, but it has to be done in the right order, because you can't restore something to a path that doesn't exist. So you have to restore everything to the right path.
Actually, the latest command will create the path for you.
Really?
If you restore, yeah.
Oh, cool. I worked this like 2 years ago, but
which version?
It's an X4AD thing, so what's the latest Windows Server version? 2012.2, I believe?
2012.3.
Oh, okay.
Does that
cool.
require a 7 domain functional level, though?
What?
Does that require a 7 domain functional level?
I don't know, it just looks for me.
Alright. Anyway. When I first wrote this, or actually I didn't wrote the script from the beginning, I got it from one of my colleagues, and I was taking his script and I added a bunch of parameters, a bunch of features, a lot of error handling, and some structuring. But first of all, if I'm using obviously older versions, Jeff tells me, I have to, the OU where the object was deleted from has to exist for me to restore it to that place. So if I restore an OU and a bunch of sub OUs, I have to restore them in the right order. And it's not that easy to find out which objects that should go where and so on. And also I can have conflicting objects. If I create a user, I call it user one in a certain place, I delete it and I create a new user called user one. If I try to restore everything from that OU, it'll restore both objects, but it'll restore one object and then it will try to restore the other, and it's gonna say that's a conflict, so it can't happen. So that's where I use my restore AD tree. So just for laughs, I'm going to take the user container here, which contains all my users, and I'm gonna delete it. And hopefully I would have protected from accidental deletion set on my OU, so I can't do this. That my demo wouldn't work, so I don't have it here. And also I have a computer, so I have a client that I removed. Now I want to restore all objects that used to be in the company OU and everything below it. that's where I have the restore SW83. There are two parameter sets to this command. One is specifying the identity of a live object, which is a non-deleted object. And the other one is to specify the last known name of the last known RDN. So I can either specify the last known RDN, which is the last known relative distinguished name, the name of the object that I want to restore. So maybe client 01 is something I can restore. But this will only restore one, and I can use wildcards.
Can you browse the recycle bin to see what's in there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You have the Active Directory Administrative Center. It has the deleted objects, so I can see what's in my recycle bin if I want to GUI. And I can also use get AD object and with the parameter include deleted objects, and I will get deleted objects. But now I want to restore, so to make it fast, I'm just going to copy distinguished name of this one. Oops. Distinguished name. So I give the identity a currently existing OU, the distinguished name of the OU. And if I want to, I can specify a time filter, a date time object, and it will only restore objects back to that time. So anything deleted before that won't be restored. But I specify the switch include live children, which kind of sounds a bit morbid maybe, but it means that I will search for anything deleted from the company OU, and once that is done, it will search for anything deleted from the computers OU and so on. If I only want to restore stuff in the company, so if I don't use the include live children, it will only restore my users folder, users OU, and any OU within that OU. But now it will recursively go through my whole structure below the company OU and restore everything it wants. Fine. And I'm going to do it verbose, and I'm also going to use the switch pass through, and I'm going to say the result, then say result. So $result equals my command, and pass through will give me objects of every restored object, and that way I can know what was restored. So if I run this, I get a lot of verbose output, and it's gonna tell me that it searches a certain place and it restores. If it finds anything, it restored it, and then it's gonna see if there is something deleted from that restored object, and if it isn't, it will go to the next object and so on. So there's a lot of verbose output here. And it tells me, like, processing an object, it says it was deleted this time, it restores, and it says restore the object, and then it's searching for deleted child object of that object. So a child object of a computer account could be a BitLocker key, and so on. So it recursively restores everything. If I go back here and have a refresh, you see that both my OUs are back and all my users are back. Also, in my result, in my result variable will be users object, well, all the objects that was restored, so I can use the content of this variable to export to CSV or do something with it to see what was restored or not. And also the command line fully supports what if and confirm. So if I do a what if, it's gonna tell me what would have been restored but won't restore anything. And if I do confirm, it will ask for every object. Found this object, do you want to restore, yes or no? So this has been a lifesaver a few times when someone calls and say, hey, you know, I think I deleted something I shouldn't. What do I do? And if they have the recycle bin enabled in AD, you can easily restore everything, and you can use get date and add hours one and say restore everything that was deleted in the last hour.
Is there any good reason not to have it enabled? Is there a performance penalty or?
You get more objects than AD, but as long as you don't have an AD with extremely many users, then obviously that won't be a problem. That was all for me. Any questions? Great. Thank you very much.